start off by showing you a short video, just to give you a bit of an idea of what ocean rowing looks like. I also have to say, I'm feeling a bit starstruck to be in the same room with the James Caird boat, the boat that Shackleton and his six of his men rowed from from Antarctica to South Georgia. It didn't take them as long as any of my ocean crossings, but certainly it was a lot colder where they were, and they had to share the boat with five hairy guys, which I never had to do, thank heavens. So I'd like to just show you a short video. It's about 3 minutes, and this is from my first ever ocean rowing voyage, the Atlantic. I wish I could say it was the highlights, but actually it's the lowlights. So without further ado, let's go ahead.
I'm not having a good day. My right shoulder blade is giving me serious jip. Quite a bit of pain with the shoulder and stuff. All kind of crusty and ugh. My bum is really sore. Just keep going, just keep rowing. This is the trouble with oceans. There seems to be always not enough of something, or too much of it. Absolute dead calm. And this is choppy compared with what it was like first thing. The wind is pushing me south. It's being pushed north. Now south of Antigua, more south. I'm weary and I've been out here for too long and I can't get on the phone to have a whinge to anybody else. Very, very hard going. Oh my God, but it's gonna be hard. A strong urge just to curl up in my bunk. Tired, pissed off, sore. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough to take.
Where you've embarked on a really ambitious project and you get a little way into it and you start thinking, why did this ever seem like a good idea? Well, that's what I'm here to talk about today, how to keep on going when everything's going pear-shaped and you're really wondering what on earth possessed you to embark on that project in the first place. Because if you're lucky enough to have never been in that situation yet, believe me, one day you will be. If you're ever pushing yourself outside your comfort zone, without a doubt, at some point, that doubt will kick in and you'll be thinking, this is such a bad idea. So how do you keep on going? But first, a little bit of backstory, because I want you to know, I am really not a sporty person. In case you're mistaking me for one of those sort of intrepid, adventurous people, that is so not me. I started out like most people do, as a baby. This is me, aged about 2 weeks old, with my beautiful mother. She looking serene and calm and little suspecting just what ordeals I was going to put her through over the coming years. As I went through school, I was quite a normal child, although particularly bad at sports. You know, most of the girls' sports at school, it's things like netball and hockey and tennis and all of those things involving sticks and balls that I'm really very bad at. So I was always last to be picked for any of the teams at school. But when I went to university, I thought, well, I really want to get more into exercise. I have to say, I was largely motivated by wanting to be able to eat more without getting fat. That was my noble motivation. And I wanted something that didn't involve sticks and balls. And so I decided to take up rowing. And I found to my great surprise that not only did I enjoy it, but I was actually quite good at it. I'm really too short to be a rower. I'm only 5'4", which is very short, even for a lightweight. But I made up for my lack of stature by being extra keen and training extra hard. Before I carry on, do we have any rowers in the room here? Great. Any tempted to row across an ocean?
Please try again.
Well, let's see how you feel about it by the end of my talk today. So I graduated back in 1989, which I know is in the Middle Ages as far as a lot of you are concerned. That was back in the era when we all wanted to be London yuppies. We all wanted to be investment bankers or management consultants. And I had no better ideas of my own. And so I followed the crowd into the City of London as a management consultant. And I think from day one, I knew that it wasn't really what I wanted to do with my life. But I thought it would serve as a stopgap until I figured out what I really did want to do when I grew up. But 11 years later, I was still in my stopgap. It's very easy to fall into the salary trap where you look around to find more worthwhile work and you look at the job ads and you think, I can't survive on that. And so you end up staying where you are. But with every passing day, I was becoming more and more despondent. My self-esteem was really going down the pan. It reached a point of real desperation. And so I turned to self-help books. And in one particular book called The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, who's read it? Okay, quite a few hands going up. And one of the 7 habits is to begin with the end in mind. And so he invites you to do an exercise, which might sound a bit morbid, but it is powerful. He invites you to imagine the ultimate end, like your own funeral. So there you are in the box at the front of the chapel, and you're trying to imagine what would people be saying about you. And you write 2 different versions of this. You write what you want them to be saying about you and what they're actually going to say about you if you carry on as you are. And I can remember how I felt as I wrote a fantasy version of my own eulogy. It wasn't specific, it didn't really talk about, certainly didn't talk about rowing across oceans, but it was about living adventurously. It was about being bold and getting out there and taking on big challenges and wanting to make a difference in the world, trying to make the world a better place in some way. That people would say, yeah, she always did her best. She did make a difference. She tried hard and she didn't always succeed, but even when she failed, she would pick herself up and dust herself off and try again. And I felt so excited as I was writing that fantasy obituary about this courageous version of me that it actually felt incredibly real. It was as if I'd opened a doorway into a parallel universe where I was living the life that I was really meant to be living. And then I wrote the version that I was heading for if I carried on as I was. And it was nice and it was safe and there was absolutely nothing at all wrong with it, but it just wasn't what I wanted. So I wish that I could tell you that I went into the office the next day and told my boss what to do with his job and strode out to live a life of adventure. But I didn't, because I was nowhere near brave enough to do that. I think part of the problem was that I had become very, very good at jumping through other people's hoops. You know, at school, I was the girly swot. I was good at passing exams and getting a pat on the back for a job well done. And it was very difficult for me to step outside that conventional definition of success and do something very risky and very scary. But it was as if subconsciously, actually, I think it was really my heart knew what it wanted to do. It knew that there was this much more vivid, colourful life out there just waiting for me, if only I could find the courage to embrace it. And so over the course of the next 2 or 3 years, my life changed quite a lot. I quit my job, my relationship ended, I moved out of my house, and my mum probably thought everything had gone horribly wrong, my life looked like a complete train wreck, but actually it was very liberating to really make a mess of some things and realise that the world keeps turning and the sun keeps rising, that failures are actually survivable. So it was around this time that I was really wanting to have a big adventure. Mentioned in the introduction, I went on an expedition to Peru. And there I started to find out about some of the environmental challenges that we're facing. I went on a big trek up into the mountains, and the people I was with were telling me that every year when they go up there, the glaciers have retreated a bit further, and they have to walk a bit further to get there. And I was like, what's with this? And so when I got back to England, I did my research and found out all about climate change and about all the other environmental challenges that we're facing. And I got so fired up about that. I was almost frantic, you know, I had to do something to raise awareness of these issues. I know now I think we're much more aware of all of these problems, but back then in the dark ages, there just wasn't as much awareness, and I really wanted to do something. But what? I was just a burned out management consultant. That's not a very compelling platform. Doesn't get you many Twitter followers. So as luck would have it, around that time I made friends with a guy who had rowed across the Atlantic with somebody rather unusual, his mother. And up until that point, I thought that to have an adventure, you had to look like this. Like, you had to be a big dude with a beard. So to find out that someone's mum could row across the Atlantic, I was like, well, I know how to row. How hard can it be? And so with immense naivety, I signed up to do the Atlantic rowing race in 2005. And I was completely convinced that I was going to have this amazing experience out there. Because I was out there like as a champion for Mother Nature, right? I was trying to raise awareness of our environmental issues. So I fondly imagined that Mother Nature would go, thank you, Roz, I'm so grateful. I'm going to send you lovely, gentle breezes to whisk you sweetly across the ocean, 3,000 miles to the other side. As you saw in the video, it didn't turn out quite that way. I'd picked quite possibly the worst year to row across the Atlantic. You know, a storm has to be a certain size before they bother to give it a name. Well, in 2005, there were 28 named storms in the Atlantic. The next worst year on record only had 20. So it was a catastrophically bad year. Hurricane Katrina, Rita, Wilma. So my timing could have been better. But even before I ran into the storms, I can remember how I felt as I set out from that little marina in the Canaries to row 3,000 miles. The trouble started about 6 hours after I started, when I found myself hanging over the side of the boat, being horribly seasick. Does anybody here get seasick? It's not fun, is it? It's really, as they say, you spend half the time thinking you're going to die, the other half wishing that you would. So I knew from past experience that I would get over it, but it still wasn't much fun as I lay there in my little boat that first night, listening to the waves crashing around the cabin, the boat's tipping like crazy. It's very, very dark on the ocean, and I'm lying there alone on my boat, feeling very small and very scared. Just to give you a bit of a mental, I've got, do you like the visual prop that I brought with me today? My boat was almost exactly the same size as the James Caird, 23 feet long and about 6 feet wide. So it's a small boat to cross an ocean in, but it's quite a big boat to row. So just picture that boat, but it's tipping around all of the time. The waves don't stop at night. And as you saw in the video, a lot of things went wrong. You don't have to be a rower to know that oars are not supposed to look like this. I'd broken all four of the oars before I even reached halfway. After I broke my camping stove, I had to eat all of my freeze-dried meals cold. I mean, it's food, but it's not great. The boat would capsize in the big waves. I mean, it's designed to cope with capsizers. It'll pop the right way up. But it's still not very much fun when you're sucked inside the sleeping cabin at the stern end, thrown around like a rag doll in a washing machine. On a later voyage, I'm jumping around a bit here just to kind of give you the worst of the worst of all of my ocean experiences. My first attempt on the Pacific, I ended up meeting these handsome gentlemen of the US Coast Guard when I got airlifted into their helicopter, not the circumstances in which I wanted to meet them. I broke my finger. I broke my water maker, which is the desalination plant that takes seawater, turns it into fresh water for me to drink. When I was going through the doldrums, where the wind just drops away to nothing, and this is where the sailors of old were all supposed to go insane, and I can really see why, because it gets so hot when there's not a breath of wind. It was about 40 degrees on the deck, and I just don't do well with heat. I came out in this horrible heat rash that itched like mad for about 2 months. There were squalls that would come in and absolutely soak me, and sometimes it would be hailstones flying horizontally, which is quite painful. For a while on the Pacific, three booby birds decided that they were going to hitch a ride on my boat. And you would have thought it'd be quite nice for me to have the company, but actually they are the smelliest, stupidest birds that I have ever met. And they proceeded to just poop liberally all over my solar panels, which does not improve their performance at all. One day I got bombarded by low-flying squid who were trying to evade a predator underneath the waves, and so they projected themselves out of the water and landed on my deck to my great surprise and alarm, scared the living daylights out of me. And the worst of it was that when a squid is scared, not only does it fly, which I didn't know anyway, but it also squirts ink everywhere. So there was this horrible, disgusting mess on my deck. But probably the closest that I ever came to actually dying was entirely my own stupid fault. It was a beautiful, calm day, and I accidentally dropped a boat hook overboard. I'd been using it to prop up my sun canopy, and I should have known better. I hadn't tied it onto the boat, and it duly flopped over the side. And because I'd done so much campaigning around not polluting the oceans, like especially with plastic and other man-made objects, I thought, well, I can't just leave it there. I'd best go and get it. So I took off my sun hat and my rowing gloves and my shoes and hopped overboard to go back and fetch it. I swim over this way, pick up the boat hook, and then look to see where the boat is, and realise that as I've been swimming that way, the boat's been drifting that way, and now it's quite a long way away. Spoiler alert, I do survive. So I tried to swim back to the boat with this 4-foot pole in my hand, and obviously that's quite difficult. So eventually I realise I'm going to have to abandon the pole. So I leave that behind, but by that point I'm quite tired, and I'm trying to catch up with the boat, and I can remember just feeling the water slipping between my fingers as I'm like trying to catch up, and it feels like I'm just not making any ground on it at all. And I start to really panic and think, is this how it's going to end? And it might sound a bit corny, but honestly, what helped me find that extra kick of speed that I needed was thinking about my poor, long-suffering mum and how it would just kill her if they found my boat at sea with nobody on board. we'd lost my dad just the year before I set out on my first ocean, and I could not let her lose her elder daughter as well. So I was like, I'll do it for Mum, and I managed to just find that bit of extra speed that I needed and eventually reach out and grab hold of those black lines and pull myself back onto the boat. So on the Atlantic, at last, after a very, very long voyage, every single day I struggled, I suffered, I wondered why it had seemed like a good idea. Fortunately for me, it's logistically very difficult to quit in the middle of an ocean. You can't just catch the bus home. And so after 103 very long days, so 3.5 months, I set out on November the 30th. I was out there for Christmas, for New Year, for Valentine's, and nearly for Easter as well. I finally made it into English Harbour in Antigua. Has anybody here been to Antigua? It is a fantastic place. It looks especially good when you've been at sea for 3.5 months. And you know that there's going to be a nice comfortable bed and a hot shower there waiting for you. And so I stepped ashore, and it was the best moment of my life. This is what it feels like to step ashore after 3.5 months alone at sea. The last 24 days with no communications at all. And I was so looking forward to seeing my mother, who'd been such a real pillar of strength for me throughout. I spoke to her on the phone nearly every day until the phone broke. And never once had she said to me, through all of my whinging and whining, she'd never said, well, I could have told you it was a really bad idea. So what have I learned from all of this? And I realise it's 1 o'clock, so let's gallop through this. I used to think that you had to have courage before you could do something courageous. Now I absolutely believe that it's the other way around. That if you wait for the courage to arrive first, you'll be waiting for a very long time. That what you need to do is to find something that just motivates you so much. Like for me, that was my passion for the environment. It could be something completely different for you. It could be your family. It could be wanting to do good in the world in some other way. It could be loyalty to your friends. It could be some other purpose. But find something that just gets you really motivated so that you can take the action. Because I really believe that when your motivation is bigger than your fear, that's when you're able to move forward with courage. And I think we end up at a very different place at the end of a lifetime if we're able to consistently push ourselves outside of our comfort zones. And of course, that's not always fun. The reason it's called your comfort zone is because getting outside of it is by definition uncomfortable. So there will be those times that you're thinking, I'm really not enjoying this all that much. But afterwards, you'll be so glad that you did it. So, you know, it's easy for us to be courageous when we're young, often because we don't know any better. But if we don't keep pushing ourselves, it's easy to just tail off as we get older. But if we keep pushing ourselves, then we end up at a very different level of achievement at the end of a lifetime. And of course, it doesn't feel like a nice smooth curve, because life's not like that. There'll be days when you're feeling courageous and days when you're not. But if you could just keep on going, so much of success is just not quitting. So I did want to do a little exercise, but I think maybe what I will do is give it to you as homework. It's a very, it's a nice bit of homework because it actually involves you closing your eyes, but no falling asleep. So let's just do a very mini, I'll do like the 1 minute version of it now. But if you can, then please do repeat this. So just, if you feel comfortable to, then close your eyes. If you don't like closing your eyes in public, then just look down. And take a couple of deep breaths. And get really nice and relaxed. And now I'd like to invite you to think, to dream of how you would like to feel when you've just achieved something really amazing. Maybe you have a specific dream in mind. maybe you have a resolution for 2018, or maybe you have a longer term goal, or maybe you know what you want to do with your whole life. So just picture what that is and see yourself in that place where you've succeeded. And think about what you're hearing. Are there people applauding you? Or is it just a quiet voice inside your own head saying, job well done? How does it feel? What are your emotions? Can you feel that pride, that feeling in your chest and your heart as you've got your shoulders back and feeling, knowing that it's a job well done? Are you feeling tall? Are you feeling strong? Are you feeling powerful? Just really inhabit that image as much as you possibly can. See the colours, hear the sounds, smell the smells, feel the sensations in your body of that wonderful sense of satisfaction, of achievement, of pride. Just really relish that feeling for a moment. And now, still with your eyes closed, gently bring your perspective right back to here and now, in this moment, and think about the one tiny step that you need to take next to get from where you are now on that journey to where you want to be. What's the one oar stroke or the one step that you need to take on that journey? And feel a sense of resolve that you're going to take that step. And see that line connecting that tiny little step, insignificant as it may seem, to that ultimate destination where you want to be. And as you go forwards, when you have those moments when you are wondering why this ever seemed like a good idea, just conjure up that image again of where you want to end up and how wonderful and powerful and life-enhancing that's going to feel. And connecting to that real sense of joy and pride will help you to keep going through all of the glitches and the road bumps and the capsizes and the big waves and the storms that might happen along the way. So much of success is just not quitting. And take a final deep breath, and then I'd like to invite you to gradually open your eyes and come back into the room. Is everybody still awake? Excellent. So just a final, we're going to be really tight on time, but I do have a little gift for you, or 15 little gifts actually. On my website, I've got some little posters which you can just download as JPEGs and print them off with little motivational quotes on them, on top of various photographs of me. So if you this URL, it's myname.com/gifts, which is like a secret page on my website that I created specially for today, so that you could just go and choose whichever quotes you'd like to download, print them off, stick them on the fridge, put them on the notice board here or at home, wherever you'll see it. So I hope that those serve to inspire you, help you keep going through your own challenges. I do have a final video, which, like all the happy bits, okay, I'm giving thumbs up for that. So earlier you saw all the miserable bits, all the low lights. So I just want to bookend that with now all the highlights, the happy bits, which I have to say correlate strongly with arriving on dry land. So this is my arrival at the end of the Atlantic, and the arrivals at the end of each of the three stages across the Pacific, where I stopped in Hawaii, Kiribati and Papua New Guinea. And then if we've got a few more moments after that, I'd be really delighted to take any questions. If we don't have time for questions and you do want to get in touch, my email address is roz@rozsavage.com. Pretty easy to remember. Okay, cue video. Let's just do this the old-fashioned way. Have we got time for a few questions? Timekeepers? How about two questions? Okay. Two super quick ones. Yes?
How did you get your boat?
My boat
had actually originally been built for somebody else, but when I bought it, it was just a shell. It had a really terrible rowing seat on it and
very basic foot stretcher, so I had to get everything kitted out on it, the whole electrical system with the solar panels,
the first aid kit, the toolkit, all of the food, all of the GPSs and all of that kind of gear.
So it was
rather expensive. If you think about it,
I reckon it cost me about £70,000 to do my first ocean, which I tried to get sponsorship for, but I did well with sponsorship for the later oceans, but I think I had a bit of a pregnancy problem for the first one, so it was a bit more challenging. Yes.
How did you mentally prepare yourself for the Pacific, knowing what it was actually going to be like this time around?
It was really difficult. I think I was definitely committed to doing the Pacific. In my mind, I was definitely going to do all three. But even so, between the Atlantic and the Pacific, whenever I actually thought about it, I would get this awful feeling of dread, because you're exactly right. This time, I didn't have the naivety anymore. I knew exactly what I was letting myself in for. But there were so many reasons I really wanted to do the Pacific. I felt I still had so much work to do with the environmental mission. And also, I felt I'd really learned a lot on the Atlantic about how not to row across an ocean. And I really wanted to learn the lessons from that and put myself back into that very challenging situation again to see if I could do it better. And I'm happy to say there was a lot less whinging on the Pacific than there was on the Atlantic. That's the question. Two more then, I'll try and keep them quick. So,
is there another challenge in
the pipeline? Oh, I do hope not. I've sold my rowboat now. I mean, definitely still environmental challenges. I'm still working on these issues, but not from a rowboat.
That was going to be my question.
Oh, okay. All right, so that sounds like a good point to stop. Thank you very much. Okay.
When I was younger, I used to think that you had to have courage before you did something of significance, something important. And I've learned now that actually it works the other way around, that you have to find the motivation to push yourself outside of your comfort zone, and it's by the doing that you find the courage. You don't get courage by sitting on the couch eating cookies.